Thank you. Yes. Morning to the people online as well. Thanks for joining us. How many of you know that we serve an amazing God? Hello? I said, how many of you know that we serve an amazing God? You do? Are you sure? How many of you? You serve an amazing God, yeah? Okay. Invite the Art 2.0. Let's join me on stage. Thank you. Turn to your neighbor and say, isn't God good? Isn't God good? Turn to your neighbor and say, isn't God good? Isn't God good? Yes, yes. Wow, thanks for joining us. Today, we have the Art 2.0 worship team who will be joining us today. So let's come to the front. As many of us, let's come to the front and worship with them. Yes. Are you ready to praise God? Are you ready to praise God? Are you?
Yeah. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Amen, church. Let's keep it going, man. Let's not stop. Let's give glory to God, to the King of Kings. Come on, church. We know how to praise God. It's not unto us. It's not unto man. Let's lift our voices. Let's praise God. We don't have to start this worship until we can praise God. We can open our mouths. We can come closer. However you know God is God, you can praise Him, you can worship Him. Even if you're sitting down, you can challenge yourself to stand up. If you're in your seat, you can challenge yourself to come closer onto the King of Kings, onto the Lord of Lords. Amen. 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 It is fantastic to be here. Good morning, church. It's amazing to be back in this building. We've missed this place. We love you guys so much, and it's a privilege, it's an honor to be worshiping with you guys today. And if you know something about 2.0, those of you who don't know, we're from 2.0. But this is especially nostalgic for me because I started from Forest Gate, and I love Forest Gate Church. So if you know something about 2.0, we love to praise God. We love energy. We don't like to be stale. So if you're here, can you just stretch your body? Because it's okay to move. Just, can we just stretch? It's okay to, thank you, Jasna. God bless you. Just stretch. You know when we're in primary school, we learn some, let's just stretch. And as we start this morning, we're just going to sing Amazing God. So just before we start, I challenge you to, you know, when you're in your seat, it's really comfortable to be where you know. If you're someone who stays in your seat, I dare you, I challenge you to just step out, to just take a step closer. If you've not said hello to someone, say hello to someone. Because after all, it's not unto man, it's unto God. So can someone just say, you are amazing God? Louder, can you say, you are amazing God? Can we say He's perfect in all of His ways? Can we say that we will lift up our voice onto the King of Kings? That's how simple our song is going to be this morning. And we're just going to wait for the band to sing this song. But whilst we start, we're just going to keep adoring God. So keep ministering unto Him and just saying some words unto God. Amen.
Amazing God,
perfect in all, and I
praise you.
stop clapping unto God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, church. How many of us know that the Lord is mighty? How many of us know that the Lord is mighty? So let's just continue into this moment of praise. Amen. Lift up our hands.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Sing, Lord.
glory,
all glory,
and all honor,
all honor,
all praise,
all praise,
all praise,
all praise
to the mighty God we serve. Sing it out, church, the mighty God. Angels would bow before the mighty God. Soon we'll sing it again. What a mighty God! What a mighty God! Sing, angels in heaven will bow before mighty God. Can we just stay in that posture of worship? Just whisper a few words unto God. I don't know what you've known God as this week. If God has been okay in your life, you can stay silent. If he's been mediocre, you can stay silent. But as for me, I know that I'm going to worship unto God. Some of us, this is the only time we've had to remember God this week. So why don't we remember? We know that God is not a God of persecution. That even though sometimes we remember to worship him only once in a week, he still pours out his love upon us. You know, this morning we were praying. Deborah, she said a prayer about the world. And it's our request, it's our desire that at one point in time, the whole world will come to know Jesus as God. And some of us in our own families, our own friends, we're still waiting for the day until some of us will see our family and friends see God. And that is our desire. And I know it's something that I'm personally waiting for. So as we sing this song, as we sing, yes, the world will bow down and say that you are God, I want you to personally think about people in your own families, in your own friendships. We're going to sing a few songs this morning that are really going to just intercede on our friends and families, because we know that God is the King of glory. Yeah. Oh. Yes, the world will bow down and say you are God. Every man will bow down and say you are king. So let's start. Why should we wait? King of glory, fill this. We just want to be with you. We just want to be with you. Sing, church, sing, King of glory. Yeah. We just want to be with you.
From the top, church, we're going to sing it again.
Sing, yes, the world will bow down. Sing, every man on earth will bow down. So let's start right now. Why should we wait? Sing, King of glory. Sing, fill this place. God, we just want to be with. will realign our posture to sing hallelujah. Until you come, the things of the world won't choke us up, they won't silence us, no. Until you, hey, we'll sing hallelujah. Declaration, sing, King of Glory, fill this place, oh God, we just want to be with you, 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 so we can behold of your glory, just one. We just want to be with you. Just want to be with you. We just want to be with you. We just want to be with you. I feel like some of us need to make that promise this morning. We just want to be with you. We just want to be with you. We just want to be with you. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. There is only one name. There is only one name with power to save. With power to save. There is only one name. There is only one name with power to save. With power to save. There is only one name. There is only one name. Sing it, church. There is only one name with power to save. With power to save. Our God, He is champion, He reigns forevermore, champion, He reigns forevermore, forevermore.
With power to save.
To the King right now. Lift up a sound of worship to the King right now. He is worthy. He is worthy. He is the chain breaker. He is the atmosphere shifter. Yes, he is. Lift up a sound of worship to the King right now.
Heaven open. Our God, he is champion. He reigns forevermore, forevermore. Our God is champion.
He is champion.
He reigns forevermore.
Song to start. God is personal to you. You can say whatever you need to say to him in this moment of worship. Whether it's one word you want to repeat onto him, keep doing that. Whether it's you want to profess your love for him, keep doing that. Whether you want to intercede for your family, for your friends, keep on doing that. I just urge you not to stay silent.
Who is like you, Lord? Matchless love and beauty, endless world, and nothing in this world can satisfy. 'Cause Jesus, you're the cup that won't run dry. And who is like you, Lord, in all the earth? Sing church, matchless beauty. And nothing in this world can satisfy. Cause Jesus, you're the cup that won't run. Sing your presence is heaven to me. Oh God, we sing your presence is heaven.
You are the...
Can we get a clap, church?
Let's give the Lord a shout. Let's bless God right now. Everybody's hands raised, Lord. Give the Lord a shout. Give the Lord a shout. Bless His name, Lord. We bless Your name, Lord. We bless you, Lord. We magnify You, Lord. Lord, You've done so much for us, Lord. Lord, You picked us up when we were down. You were there for us when we needed You, Lord. When we had no one to turn to, Lord, You were there for us, Lord. Lord, You continue to bless us. Continue to bless us. The last song we sang before that, the lyrics was Redeemer of my past and present wrongs. And what was the next line? Holder of my future. Just meditate on those lyrics. It doesn't matter what our past looked like. It doesn't matter. Lord, He redeemed us. He brought us out from that. And He holds our future. So let's give the Lord a shout one more time. Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. You may be seated. I'm Uzo. I'll be your moderator today. Welcome to those joining us online as well. Welcome to you. Let's give a round of applause to Art 2.0 as well. Thank you for blessing us today. Sharon, Rachel, Orobosa, Daniela, Abraham, thank you so much. And thank you to the instrumentalists as well. Let's give them a round of applause as well. Yes, yes. The last time I saw Daniela in Art Forest Gate was last month. And she was walking down the aisle in a nice, lovely white dress with Toby. So yeah, let's give them a round of applause to the newly Toby's an Art 2.0 right now, yeah? Yeah, so lovely, lovely. It was an amazing wedding. My plate was full. That's when I know it's a good wedding, when my plate is full. Yeah, so yeah. Next, I would like to welcome a team, but online there was a video posted of me and it was about the media team. And I said that the media team is the best ministry. And I'm also in the welcome team, so I had some side eyes in the group chat from people in the welcome team saying, are you sure? Especially Holly. Yeah. Natalie, G-Money, Georgia. Yeah. So I would like to welcome up a welcome team that is full of amazing people, wonderful people, diligent, hardworking people, and the friendliest bunch in church.
Hello, hello, everybody. Uzo, we're just going to pretend that was a slip up and you didn't mean it. But hi, guys, my name is Abrefi. I'm part of the welcome team. We actually met a few people at the door. We have Michael, I think he's Jockey's friend, who's new today. Silla, Uavachi, Whitney, and Phyllis. Welcome, guys. If we missed you, don't worry. One of the ushers is going to come around and they're going to give you a welcome pack. It's got a little QR code inside. Please, please scan it for us. It's just for us to get to know you. Just fill out the form just so we can keep in touch. And if there's anyone new in the congregation, please put your hand up. Don't worry, we're not going to make you do anything weird. Hi, welcome. Welcome, welcome, welcome. If you're sitting next to anyone new, you know how we do it here in ARC. Give them a warm welcome. Make them feel a part of the family. And guys, enjoy your service. Thanks,
Maya. Thank you, thank you. Now I'm going to do some announcements. But before I do that, I might as well announce some birthdays that we've had this week. We've had quite a few. I think the first one I saw was Priscilla. It was her birthday early on this week. Then we had Chi-Chi, yeah. Yesterday we had Sharina. Camille, we also had Camille, yeah. Do we have any more, did anyone else celebrate their birthday this week? Anyone? So I guess, in usual tradition, let's sing them happy birthday. Could I ask if anyone could help me out? Okay. What's the key? Happy
birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday.
One more time, let's go. Lovely stuff, lovely stuff. Yeah, moving on to the announcements, if the media team could help me out on that one as well. First announcement is Bible study. So Bible study, we have Christian Concern that has been joining us this month on Bible study. It's every Thursday at 7 p.m. Has anyone been to Bible study this month? Hands up. Have you enjoyed it? It's been amazing. There's so many new things changing in our culture, and the world is changing rapidly, so it's important for Christians to be equipped biblically as well. So yeah, this Bible study is tackling cultural things, four-part series, so there's two parts left. This Thursday, I hope to see as many people as I can there. But if you can't join us, obviously some people might be working, yeah, you can also join us on YouTube. So yeah, we'll be streaming. Next one, we have the ARC Dagenham anniversary service. That is next Sunday. So ARC Dagenham is turning 1 year. Let's give a shout. Lovely, lovely. So yeah, they've got the anniversary service, which is next Sunday. So that's from 4:30 to 7 p.m. And it's called Worship, Word and Wonders. I love that. What's the word for that? alliteration. Worship, word, and wonders. I love that. So yeah, we also have worship by Ark 2.0. Again, they'll be there as well. And then worship from Ark for Escape. They'll be there. So yeah. Hope to see as many people there as possible because we are better together. Love that. Cool. Next announcement, please. Oh, we have the new believers course as well, which begins on Wednesday. So yeah, new believers course is amazing. When I joined ARC, that's something I joined. It was really insightful. I learned a lot about the Bible and all the facts and figures. And if you want to know any more facts, yeah, like how many chapters are in, you know, how many books are in this Testament, you know, just, and some you know, early history. But yeah, I learned a lot. So honestly, if you want to go there, learn some stuff, it's amazing. You can see TJ about the New Believers course, he's there, and MK, who's not here, but if you see him around, then yeah, that's someone else you can speak to about it as well. Yeah, next. Also, we have some more events and announcements, but if you see in the foyer, we have a little computer there, so that has some more events and flyers. So if you walk past there and you see anything, turn to there. Yeah, next I would like to invite Shanique, who will give us a word of encouragement.
Good morning, everybody. So I've been given the opportunity to share an encouraging word today. And today's the theme of the month is on a little leaven leavens the whole lump, found in Galatians 5:9. And so I'm going to talk about a specific type of leaven that has negatively affected the church today. So leaven can symbolize different types of sin or false doctrines that corrupt the church. And some examples of a little leaven include the sin of pride, the sin of wickedness, the sin of malice, and some false doctrines, for example, the free grace gospel or the works-based gospel, and you've probably heard of some of them. The type of leaven that I'm going to speak about today is called the lonely gospel. So when I was 15 years old, my mom, she died to cancer. She didn't undergo chemotherapy, so we kind of watched her body wither away. So it was hard. Not only was it hard as a 15-year-old losing your mom, but it was also hard to watch her deteriorate into flesh and bones. But despite that, despite her body perishing, her spirit was being renewed day by day. She had a supernatural encounter with God, and eventually she gave her life to Christ. It was a rough period for me, of course, as it would be for anyone. And without my older sister, Tiffany, a few family members and school friends at the time, I don't know how I would have overcome. Looking back, after my mom's death, I definitely grew cold, didn't want to talk to people, I didn't care about relationships, friendships. I felt like nobody cared about me or just cared about the situation, and I felt like no one could help. And without realizing, I had developed the leavenous, lonely gospel. So I want to ask everybody a question today. No, actually, before I ask you a question, upon growing and maturing in my faith and reading scripture, I couldn't ignore the reality and the importance of fellowship and love. So for example, in 1 Peter 4 verse 8, it says, "And above all things, have fervent love for one another, and love will cover a multitude of sins." Ecclesiastes 4:9-12 says, "Two are better than one, because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fall, one will lift up his companion. But woe to him who is alone when he falls, for he has no one to help him up. Again, if two lie down together, they will keep warm. But how can one be warm alone? Though one may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him, and a threefold cord cannot be easily broken. So I want to ask a question. Have you adopted the leavenless, lonely gospel? Maybe due to trauma, maybe you felt like no one cared, or maybe you just didn't want to burden anyone. I can share with you from my experience of losing my mom at 15 years old, healing comes through fellowship, not through isolation. I can testify and say that there's multiple people at Ark Forest Gate that have poured into me, encouraged me, discipled me, and have contributed to who I am today. I want to share and say, don't mistake God's blessing of fellowship as a burden. It is for your benefit. Another question I want to ask, or another few questions I want to ask, and allow the Holy Spirit to reveal the answers to you and just allow Him to search your heart. Have you contributed to others adopting or developing the leavenless, lonely gospel, maybe due to a lack of selflessness or intentionality in building relationships and just loving on people? Do you only love those who it's easy to love? Do you only love those who you already have a mutual relationship with? I want to encourage us in saying to be willing to love the outcast, the brokenhearted, the unfortunate, and the disadvantaged as much as we do our family, our friends, and the people we already like. Let your love abound and flow like living waters with no limits. On Mother's Day, Zalika, she preached an amazing sermon called Carriers of the Greatest Gift, and I would encourage all of you guys to watch it on YouTube. And she spoke about quite a few things, but in particular she spoke about the importance of getting around Elizabeth's, which I 100% agree with. It says in scripture in Proverbs 12:15 that the way of a fool is right in his own eyes, but he who heeds counsel is wise. So it's definitely important to get around people who are more mature age-wise and in faith, that because they'll help you. But also, just building on what she spoke about, I think it's just as important for us to be willing to be Marys to the Elizabeths in the house. 2 Corinthians chapter 2 verses 3-4 says, blessed is the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. So just as much as it's important for us to get around Elizabeths, it's just as important for us to be Elizabeths to the Marys around. The leavenless, lonely gospel has deceived others, and it deceived me into believing that I could do my walk with Christ in isolation. The only way we can purge out this leavenless, lonely gospel is by acknowledging God's word concerning love and fellowship as truth, but also by practically exercising God's word concerning love and fellowship as truth. I pray that as we continue to develop our hearts for God, that we'll also develop a heart for His people. Thank you for listening.
Absolutely amazing. Absolutely amazing. Get around some Elizabeths. Make sure. Honestly, this house is filled with so many people. So many people that are just willing to pour their wisdom into you. So please, get around some Elizabeths. Get around some Elizabeths. Yeah, for real. Next, we have offering. Being part of the media team is really like, open my eyes to how much, you know, the importance of pouring in to the church financially, because a lot of the stuff costs a lot to run the stream, to you know, have these lights and to cameras and everything. It costs so much, and so it's really important for us to pour into the church and to advance the kingdom. There are three ways to give. So yeah, you can give via bank transfer. That's the preferred method. We also have Church Suite. So we had a nice rundown of Church Suite with Chrissy and Pastor P a couple of weeks ago. So if you're not signed up to Church Feet, then, you know, make sure. You've got other ways as well. We also have cash. So if you've got cash, coins, the ushers are going around with envelopes. So just put your hands up. And if you've got any cash or anything, they will come. And, yeah, you can give. Could I ask that we all stand, if you can? Also, I would like to just welcome people to the front as well, because we got Art 2.0 again doing offering, so it would be amazing if you know, everyone comes to the front as well again. But yeah, just quickly, I'd like to pray. Lord, thank you for everybody that has been able to give. Thank you for being a provider. I pray, Lord, that as people give, doors will open in their lives. I pray, Lord, that blessings will double, favor will double, promotions will double, engagements will double, wedding bells will double. Hey, yes. But yes, we just pray, Lord, that you will just provide. And for those that can't give, Lord, we know that you're providing, God, Lord. So just provide for each and every one of us, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. So yeah, thank you. And encourage you to come to the front. Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Worthy, 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 wor
Can we put our hands together one more time for the 2.0 team? Guys, we really appreciate you being with us today. And yeah, thank you very much. Who's ready for the word today? They don't seem too ready. Who's ready for the word today? Cool. Well, I've come to deliver the word for you. I've not really, but before I do get into it, there's really important things that we have to deal with. So first and foremost, as you know, we're a Man United church. So we want to celebrate Arsenal exiting the Champions League this week. It's a very important part of the calendar year, just in line with what I expected. So we thank God for that. But I have the honor of introducing a wonderful lady. I think Joelle's made it a bit obvious now. If somebody's preaching, their partner will introduce them. So it's a bit obvious, but I get the blessing of introducing the most beautiful woman in the church. A wonderful mother, a wonderful wife, and just a great teacher. You know, somebody asked me the other day, I got married quite young, would you have done it again or was it a mistake? And I said, if I could do it again, I would do it younger, because I continually learn from this woman. She thinks I'm joking. I'm being serious. I continually learn from you. I'm inspired by you. And please come and bless the people. Can we put our hands together for Tara Smith?
Good morning, church. it's nice to be here again. I know the last time I preached, I quoted Beyonce quite a few times, so I wasn't sure if they were going to allow me to be on this stage. Before I start, I want to shout out to Sharina again for her birthday, but also Sharina and MK are celebrating their wedding anniversary this week, or this month anyway. So shout out to you guys. Keep working on baby number 3. I see you. We're waiting. And also, before I start, this past month has been a lot for various reasons. So if you don't mind, I want to just humanize myself for a second and ask if everyone could just stand for a moment. The month has been a lot for various reasons, and I just feel fuzzy in my head, like just everything's all over the place. So can I just ask that we just spend 2 or 3 minutes just praying for me, for my heart and for my mind as I deliver this word. If you could do me that favor. Thank you. Amen. Please be seated. Thank you, family. Can everyone hear me okay? Yeah? Okay, so let's get into the word. So first and foremost, who remembers Ask Jeeves? I'm showing my age now. Okay, who doesn't remember Ask Jeeves? Let me see who the young ones are. Esther, of course. Neka, you remember Ask Jeeves. Everyone remember Ask Jeeves? It was an old search engine way before Google, and it was supposed to be like a butler. So you will put in your question, and then he'll stand like this as if he's serving you, and then you put search, and he'd run away and come back, like, I kid you not, a minute or two later, because back then it wasn't as fast as Google, and he'll come back like a butler and come and serve all the answers to you. But because the search engine game was very new at that stage, it wasn't 100% accurate or very fast. But what they had tapped into very, very early is that as humans, we have this innate desire to want to know. We want to have knowledge. We want to be able to have answers and have answers quickly. And now we've got the evolution of Google. Answers are quicker, they're more efficient. However, the USP of a search engine has never been to be very accurate. Their USP is to give you information quickly. It's never been about truth, but it's been about speed. Now we're spoilt for information. So if you have an ailment, I know myself, if you know I've got sore, my leg is sore or my arm is hurting, I don't call the doctor, I call Google. Yeah, I search and I say, oh, elbow is swelling. And then I self-diagnose myself because all the information is on Google, right? And in fact, I'll take it even further. I'll go to a doctor and say, look, I've searched this up. Don't stress yourself. Like, I know what it is and I know exactly what I need. I know how many of it I need. So just sign the paper and let's be gone. So we're so spoiled with information because information is so easy to come around. Even so much so that if you want to search a sermon on gifts of the Spirit, thousands of messages will come up. But again, the USP of a search engine is not for accuracy, it's for speed. And if you're like me, you don't look past page two. Like, when you search, page one is key information. You're lucky if I look at page two. But Google never verifies the truth of that sermon. It never verifies that the information is accurate. It's just allowing us to consume information and consume information quickly. But the problem with consuming information quickly is that we fail to take the time to test and discern what we're consuming. We become an Indomie generation, fast noodles generation. We want information. Doesn't matter if it tastes good. Doesn't matter if it's accurate. Just let me know, I want this knowledge. Now the Bible tells us about a woman who didn't have the opportunity to use Google. It was Queen Sheba. And we learn about her in 2 Chronicles 9. She's also spoken about in 2 Kings. And I'm sure we know the story of King Solomon. He was made king over Israel. And God said, you know, what do you want? And Solomon said, I want wisdom to be able to lead your people, to be able to guide your people. And God said, you know what? Because you had such a humble request, not only will I make you wise, I will make you the wisest person of the land. And not only that, I'm going to make you the richest man of the land. Now, Queen Sheba heard of this. She lived down in the south, down, you know, South London type down. And she traveled all the way from Sheba, which is now modern day Yemen, all the way to Jerusalem, just to hear the wisdom of Solomon. Just to see that, is this guy really wise? Let me ask him some questions. Let me grasp onto that godly knowledge. Now, we read about that in 2 Chronicles 9. It's literally one line. Queen Sheba went to go and visit King Solomon. But after some research, I looked into it, and that journey would have been 2,800 miles. Now, I'm not great at geography, so I still didn't really understand what that meant. So I Googled how far is 2,800 miles. 2,800 miles is the distance between the east of the USA to the west of the USA. And because you don't have planes back then, they didn't have cars back then, a lot of the journey would have been done by camel, that would have taken her 3 years. Who remembers what they were doing 3 years ago? Queen Sheba had just started her journey. 3 years for the wisdom of Solomon. Everyone say committed. Queen Sheba was committed. Remember her. I'm going to come back to her. Now, my key text is 1 John 4, verse 1 to 4. And the topic is about test every spirit. Now, 1 John 4 is not the Gospel of John. It's not the autobiography of Jesus. 1 John 4 is the pastoral letters of John. So Jesus is gone. He's gone back to heaven. And about 50, 70 years have passed. Now, you have to have this context that back then there was no New Testament scriptures for them to read. They were living in the New Testament, right? They only had the Old Testament. So their knowledge of Jesus and about his miracles, all the great things that he'd done, probably would have come from like grandparents. I can imagine someone saying, Grandma, tell me about the time that you saw Jesus brought Lazarus back to death. Tell me about that time when you saw Jesus healed that sick lady. All their information would have come from grandparents and witnesses from back then who were probably very, very old. And because of this, they were almost susceptible to false doctrine, a lot more than most other, you know, new religions. They didn't have texts to refer to as all eyewitnesses. And Pastor John knew this, and he wrote them a letter to address this. But a particular issue that he was addressing was a bunch of people had come around, and they were called Gnostics. And we get the word Gnostics from, you know, agnostics. You've got atheists, those that don't believe in God. You've got agnostics, those that are not sure what they believe. And you've got theists, those that believe. Now, these lot would come around called Gnostics. And naturally, they felt they know it all, because Gnostic is to know, to have knowledge. Now, I'm going to pretend to be a Gnostic. You guys pretend to be the early church. And they'll come around and they'll ask certain questions to kind of trip up the early Christians, to try and bring in new doctrine into the fold. So question one, I'm going to ask you guys. God is perfect, right? Be confident in it. Is God perfect? Cool. Okay. And you guys, so when Jesus came, he performed miracles, right? Okay. Cool. And when Paul came to visit us, you know, a few weeks ago, and he came and he was preaching all that kind of stuff, he said we should walk by the Spirit, right? Yeah? You guys are not confident. Early church. Yeah? All right. Because you guys are nervous, I know. I put you on notice. And when Paul came, he also encouraged us not to walk in the lust of the flesh, right? Because the flesh is bad, right? Yeah? Yeah? Cool. Okay, so as a Gnostic, with all my knowledge, I need to share with you some new doctrine. Jesus never really came, you know. He never really came. It was an illusion. Because a perfect God wouldn't have come in flesh. That's the new doctrine. He never was actually here. So I know you've heard all the stories, but a perfect God would not have come in flesh and walked in this earth. So I want you guys to go and share that new message and share that new doctrine. Now, people are looking like, oh, okay, Tara, don't be stupid. But some of your favorite preachers say even wilder stuff. They use information and create a whole new doctrine. So the Gnostics had their preconceived idea that everything in the world, everything material was evil, and only things of the spirit were good. And because of that, they preached a new gospel. And this new gospel, not even a new gospel, a new doctrine. And this new doctrine was a half-truth. Everyone say half-truth. The Gnostics accepted the divinity of God, the divinity of Jesus. They accepted he was God, but they rejected his humanity. But that can't work because the very bones of the gospel rely on you to know that Jesus came on this earth. You need to know that, yes, he came, he performed miracles, he came and he healed people. Yes, he came and he forgave sins. He was fully God. But he came on this earth for a virgin birth. He probably did chores on a Saturday as a carpenter's son. He came in the flesh. He was buried. He was abused. He was angry. He was upset. He was fully human, fully fresh, because he's fully man. Jesus is both fully God and fully man. That is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. And if any gospel comes or any preacher comes to show you something different, that is a false doctrine. Everyone say false doctrine. And it's funny now because in the 21st century, the problem's almost split, kind of the opposite now. So people are willing to accept the humanity of Jesus. You know, atheists are able to say, and historians, that yes, a guy called Jesus did come on the earth. That is true, but don't push it. He's not God. Maybe like a Mother Teresa or some type of person, but he wasn't God. Even other world religions like Islam, they say, yeah, Jesus came, he's real, he was breathing, we've seen all the documents, but he was just a prophet. Like, don't push it, he wasn't the Son of God. So now the half-truths have changed. But guys, we need to understand and we need to fully believe in the scripture that tells us when Jesus came on earth, he said, when you see me, you see the Father. He was fully God. Everyone say fully God. So to get to the scripture now, 1 John 4, verse 1-4, if the media team could pull that up for me. This is Pastor John speaking to the early church, correcting the false doctrine. Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test, everyone say test, the spirits to see whether they are from God. For many false prophets, say false prophets, have gone out into the world. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. And every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard was coming and now is in the world already. Verse 4, little children, you are from God and I have overcome them. For he who is in you, everyone say in you, is greater than he who is in the world. Amen. So the title today is Lights, Camera, Action, Test Every Spirit. Lights, camera, action, test every spirit. So Pastor P came and he preached about little leaven, leaven's the whole loaf. But before I even start, is it leaven or leaven? Are we saying leaven? Ark Forest Gate? Leaven? Because I'm pretty sure MK said leaven. Or Pastor, one of them said leaven, leaven. So it's leaven, right? Everyone agree? Okay. No? Oh, okay. All right, Bible school. We'll go to Bible school and establish. All right, Pastor P came and spoke about little leaven, leaven's the whole loaf, and the power of false doctrines within the church or even an individual that is sexually immoral can actually ruin the whole family of the faith. And MK came and he preached about don't put up with it. almost like a defensive position against false doctrines. He also preached about another Jesus, that we have sometimes false doctrines have gone around and created different counterfeit Jesuses. And I'm hoping today that I can encourage you with an offensive position. MK gave us a defensive position, but I want to give you an offensive position against false doctrine. Amen? So Pastor John says, do not believe. Very similar to MK's message, do not put up with it. But he says, test every spirit. Now the word test is a verb, and it means to take measure to check the quality, performance, or reliability of something, especially before putting it into widespread use or practice. I mean, I could end the sermon on that alone, on that definition alone. He asked us to test. That requires some activity. It requires some intentionality. But unfortunately, as 21st century believers, we've become so passive in our Christian walk. We've become so passive. We just sit down, consume, give me information, go out there, be the same, come back, feed me, go out there, be the same, don't do anything new. Passivity. And he calls us to be active. So he's saying when people are preaching, when people are sharing the word, when people are speaking authoritatively on the word of God, don't consume it and lap it up like a dog. Don't take it in with like junk food with no thought. He's saying you need to take some measures to test and discern. Everyone say, take measures. So if you don't take measures and you just consume, and you don't have any discernment, you don't take time to get into the word, what happens is that you get tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. Should I tithe? No, I shouldn't tithe. Oh yeah, but I should tithe because Jesus died for my sins. Yeah, but it's no longer 10% because it's Old Testament. Don't worry about that. Should Christians eat meat? No, Christians shouldn't eat meat. They should be vegetarians. Oh no, they should be pescatarians. No, but the scripture says this. I don't know where I am. Does God choose my spouse? Oh no, he gives us free will. But no, he can't give us free will because he's God, so therefore he must choose our spouse. But I'm not sure, so now I don't know if to go and look for a spouse or wait in my house and wait for God to bring me my spouse. You get tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine, and then you become spiritually queasy. You become a bit sick, not really knowing what you believe. But if you spend time in God's word, it will ground you, I promise you. It will provide you with a firm foundation. Because doctrine can move you like wind. Scripture tells us that. But life can be a roller coaster, right? The ups and downs of life. Even in the ups, we need scripture to remind us that it's God that gives us the power to accumulate wealth. Amen? And then when you give birth to your baby, you need to remember that it's God that gives us the blessing of children. Amen? But even in the down times, in the difficult times, you need to remember the Lord is your shepherd. He is the good shepherd. You need to remember the scripture that says that he will never leave you nor forsake you. You need to remember Romans 8:28 where it says that he works all things, bad, up, good, whatever it looks like, all things for good for those who love the Lord and called according to his purpose. Amen? So scripture gives us that foundation. It's something that we can stand on. But unfortunately, because of this Indomie generation, this quick noodle generation, this social media generation, people no longer stand firm on scripture. Instead, they stand firm on unbiblical catchphrases. Pick-me-up phrases. Phrases that sound good but have no foundation, no strength at all. But I tell you, when the winds come and the roller coasters of life come, it's only the belt of truth that can keep you firm. It's only the belt of truth that can keep you secure. It's only scripture that can be your firm foundation. One of my favorite songs, I'm going to try and sing it. Thank you. The rock on which I stand, I won't be shaken. I'll never be more glad. In Jesus, hallelujah, hallelujah. That's such a beautiful song. It's such a testament of being grounded in the word of God. But do you know, even though you sing this song, does it make it true? It can be one of your favorite songs, it could be a banger. When I hear that song, the spirit moves. But for Christ to be your firm foundation, you have to be in the word of God. There's no shortcuts. There's no lyrics that can take you there. If you're going to say he is your firm foundation, find yourself in the word. Amen? And do you remember Noah? I remember in Sunday school, that's one of the most famous stories that we all read and we all knew, understood. But upon reading the story of Noah as an older person, I realized that it must have been such a traumatic time for him. Imagine, God said, look, I'm about to wipe out this whole world. Everyone is going to die. All your favorite shops are going to die. Novikov is gone. Everything is gone. He's going to wipe everything out. And he said, you know what? Build this boat and this will protect you from being wiped out. So, of course, he's building it. He's building it. People are mocking him. I mean, the cartoon says people mock him. I'm not sure that's in the scripture. But people are mocking him. But he was building it and building it by faith. But when the flood came and he was literally watching houses and people dying and screaming for help, and he was safely in that boat, it wasn't the wood and the nails that he felt secure in. It was the specific instruction, the word of God on how to build that boat is what he had faith in. It wasn't the wood, it wasn't his hard work, it wasn't his diligence, but God, you can check the scripture, specifically told him how to build this boat. And because God gave him that word, is that word he trusted him. So Pastor John's call in 1 John 4 is to test every spirit. But that is first a call to know the truth of God's word, because you can't test if you don't know the text. Imagine now, I think we should probably see more, like when preachers come, and I'm not saying to be like crazy critics or anything, but if we saw preachers like chefs almost, they come and, you know, they spend about a week or two preparing a word for you. You know, they've got a recipe. They've prepared a really nice word for you. And they come on Sunday and they deliver it to you. Like, here, taste it. See what I've prepared for you. But no one in the congregation has taste buds. Now, people eat and some will say, okay, Tara was talking about a lot of scriptures and a lot of concepts and I didn't really understand them. So you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to go home, do a bit more research, be a bit more in my word, and develop taste buds so I can actually taste and see that this word is good. But then there's going to be some people, and some of you here, you're going to hear what I'm saying, and it's not going to make sense to you. You're not going to understand the scriptures or the context of the scriptures, and you're going to say, hey, food is food, right? I'll just come back next Sunday. Still won't be able to taste the food, really, but food is food, right? As long as I don't vomit, it's fine, I'll digest it. But the problem here is that false prophets prey on biblical ignorance. They are hoping you don't read your scripture. They are hoping you don't go home and check the scriptures. Because when you don't check the scriptures, they can go to Costco, buy a bottle of water, tell all of you that they've prayed and fasted on this bottle of water for 1 week. Now, when you drink this water, all your prayer requests will come true. But not only that, they want to charge you £250 for this £1 bottle of water. Because you've not checked your scriptures. You're not founded in the word of God. So when they come and tell you absolute nonsense, they put a price tag on it, you are more willing to purchase it. You are more willing to consume the junk. You've not developed taste buds and you take it in. This will not be our portion in Jesus' name. Thank you. You know the Nigerians, you know, this will not be our portion in Jesus' name. And like I said, I'm not calling Ark FG to become a critical church. I'm not calling you to sit in your seat and just be ready to judge if the preacher is saying something wrong or bad. I'm not asking you to have a critical spirit. What I'm asking you is to be like the Bahrain church. They got a shout out in Acts. Paul said that these people, I would come and I would preach this gospel to them and they'd go home and check their Old Testament scriptures to see if what Paul was saying was correct. They had a heart to want to understand. They had a heart to want to fully digest the word. And I'm praying over Ark FG that we will have a heart to truly want to understand the word of God. Not to come here to be entertained, but truly understand and go and search the scriptures. Amen. So Pastor John gives early Christian church a litmus test. He says in verse 2, by this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. And every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. Now, our situation is different, like I said. People accept the humanity of Jesus now, but not his divinity. But the principle still remains the same. In this 21st century, people are preaching counterfeit Jesuses, and MK preached about it last week. And the problem here is that a counterfeit Jesus can't save. There's only one name. There's only one Jesus. And when we allow ourselves to be built up on counterfeit Jesuses, for example, the tolerant Jesus, stand for nothing, accept everything, that wasn't the Jesus that I read about in the scripture. Yes, Jesus showed grace. Yes, he showed love. He saw the woman in court in adultery, and he said to them, look, unless any of you are perfect, stop throwing stones. But he didn't say, yeah, go and continue committing adultery. I've got your back. You're good. No, he said, go and sin no more. There's no such thing as a tolerant Jesus. And I know in this 21st century, we've got all these different ideologies, all these different ideas, and we're almost scared to profess what we believe in. And I understand that. I understand how difficult it can be. But don't ever let the truth waver. It's better for you to be silent than to lie and pretend. No, my God doesn't accept LGBT. I'm sorry. It just is what it is. And we have to be bold in that truth. We have to be bold in the scripture. This is what my word says. A man is a man and a woman is a woman. This is what the scripture of God says, and this is what I stand on. And I know it's uncomfortable, right? Because the world has made us uncomfortable to declare our truth. It's uncomfortable to stick to the scriptures. But I really, amen, come on. Come on. But we have to be confident in it. If we're going to say that it's our firm foundation. So, you see, Philip's gone to Dubai now, so I could just, you know, take the mic and try and do what I want to do. But if we're going to say it's our firm foundation, we truly have to believe it and stand on it and be able to rock with it. And don't get me wrong, there's grace for mistakes. What I believed 3-4 years ago, I no longer believe. There's grace for people to grow spiritually, for their doctrines to evolve. There's space for that. But that's only if you're willing to be accountable. We need to be an accountable church. If you hear someone speaking authoritatively on the matters of God, and it doesn't really sit well with you, you should feel comfortable enough to say, what scripture are you basing that on? And not in a prideful way, not in a way where you want to have contention and go back and forth from the scriptures. That's not the heart of the scripture. But because you want to understand, and you want them to also understand. Be comfortable saying, where do you base that belief on? What scripture are you basing that on? And I want us as a church to be more comfortable with that truth. And I know it's going to be a bit uncomfortable because we're going to hold each other accountable. Say to your neighbor, I'm going to hold you accountable. Say to your other neighbor, I'm going to hold you accountable. And it is going to be a bit uncomfortable because now people are going to be a bit more nervous when it comes to speaking on behalf of God. But to an extent, I think that's how we should be. Because when you speak and say, God is saying, what you then say, what you proceed to say has the same weight as let there be light. So when you speak and you declare that God is saying this, make sure God is really saying this. And don't get me wrong, there is space to say, I feel led to. I feel like the Spirit of God is leading me to. I feel like God is ministering me in this way. That is absolutely fine. We all have His Holy Spirit and we are all equipped to say those things and to move according to His prompting. However, when you say, God says, drink this water, and now you'll no longer be infertile, there's a problem. When you're giving people promises from God based on your word, be careful. Amen? And when we hold each other accountable, it's not a time to catch people out or to make people feel stupid or make people feel nervous to speak boldly, but it's to allow us to be sharpened, to sharpen one another. To be sharpened is uncomfortable, right? What knife do you hear getting sharpened and it sounds comfortable? To be sharpened is going to be a little bit painful because certain things need to be cut away. Old beliefs have to be cut away. Misunderstandings of scripture have to be cut away. And I think for too long, churches, and less so FG, but churches generally have become a bit of a community club. We've all come with a common goal, a common like. You know, we all like to play darts or whatever it is. We've all come, we all like God, right? We all like God, so we're all coming together because we all like God. And then we come and we sit in the audience and we listen to the worship. Wow, Joke and Neke left, you know, they led that beautifully. I'm definitely coming back next week. I loved her voice. And then we come and hopefully the preacher's entertaining. And we say, wow, so, and I love that joke that he said. MK is so funny, man. I'm coming next week. I'm going to buy my ticket and come next week and chill in the community club. But I feel like church should be more of a, like a football team. In fact, Can I get the leaders of the young adults team? Can I get you guys to come? All the leaders of young adults team. This is also a soft launch, so you guys know who they are. Adam, Holly, Georgia, Shimon, Chris, Luke, Shanique, Minty, Tayo, Kweku. The leaders are here. Can you just come? I'm going to use you guys. So come. Huddle, guys. Huddle. Huddle. Come around more like a circle, like a semicircle in front of me. Come around. Come around. Don't be scared, guys. Is Namdi here? No. Okay. Come around, guys. Come around like a circle. Okay, so for a very long time, I feel like church has been a community club, right? People will gather and they'll share ideas, they laugh and they go home and nothing has changed. But I honestly feel like it should be more like a football club, yeah? I'm gonna show this now. I did GCSE drama, so watch this. All right, team, get closer. You've had a fantastic week. I know some of you have been interceding. I know some of you have been at Bible study. Some of you have been praying and calling and checking up on the people. Now we're going into a new week. Yeah, guys? We need to be ready and to be equipped. Now, I know some of you might be a bit weary. You might be a bit tired on that field. Shanique, if Shimon is weary, call him. Check up on him. Yeah? Adam, if you see Luke struggling on the field, go to his house, visit him, pray for him. Yeah? Look, listen to me, Abby. You on that field, you're very, very important. You are an intercessor. You are an intercessor. And I want you to be praying for the people. I want you to be praying for the people. You are powerful, Abigail. You are more powerful than you even realize this. And I want you to pray for the people. Holly, I know it can be hard on that field. I know it can be difficult. But I want you to keep going. I want you to be strong. I want you to be grounded in your scripture this week, right? I want you to be grounded. Georgia, my striker. Look, when you get out onto that field, not only do I want you to keep checking up on the community of the faith, but I want you to evangelize, yeah? You have the spirit of an evangelism in you, yeah? And I want you to tap into that. Now look, for the week, I want you guys to be grounded in the book of Joshua. I want you to meditate on the scriptures. I want you to believe that he goes before you. Do not be discouraged. Be of good courage. Amen? Yes, are you guys ready? Yeah. We're going to go out there and preach the good news, right? Yeah. We're going to go out there and check up on people, right? Yeah. We're going to pray for people. We're going to go to Bible study, right? Yeah. Hands in. On three, say amen. One, two, three. Amen. That's how church should be. Because when you come together to come and be entertained and to enjoy, nothing really changes. But what we should have is huddles, team huddles. And I'm on stage today, so yes, maybe I'm the coach for today. But when you gather together in your little groups after service, you should be encouraging one another, edifying one another, sharpening one another. Not come here to be entertained. Be sharpened and sharpen. Amen? Amen. So point one was action. Pastor John tells us to test every spirit, which is first a call to know the text. Point two, distraction. For many prophets have gone out into the world. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. And every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you heard was coming and is now in the world already. The spirit of Antichrist, a teaching that is against Christ. Now, MK touched on this a bit last week about the types of teachings and the counterfeit Jesuses. And I'm going to touch on three today. The most obvious one, prosperity teaching. Money, cars, fame, all these things now belong to me because I name it and claim it as a Christian. Yachts and mansions, I should win the lottery. All these things are mine because I'm a child of God. But all those desires, all those requirements sound very much like an unbeliever. You don't sound very different. But I thought you're renewed. So why do your desires and your motivations look like theirs? I'm a bit confused. Now, don't get me wrong. There's nothing inherently wrong with wanting these things. But the problem with the prosperity teaching is that it teaches that we should live our best life now. It is teaching us that we deserve soft life now. It's teaching us that we deserve all these things because we are a child of God. Therefore, God must gift us with every single thing that we've asked for. Let me tell you now, if you believe that you are here to live your best life now, you must be convinced you're going to hell. You must be convinced. Because look, this world of rain, TV license bills, gray hair, the cold, public transport is not of God. Let me tell you, what we're going to go and experience in heaven is way more than anything this world can offer. This is temporary. What is a car to my God? What is money to my God? Those are minor. Level up, man. You're asking for money, cars, stuff, materialistic things that fade away. What is that to God? Prosperity teaches is an antichrist teaching because it belittles the finished work to materialistic things. He didn't die for us to prosper on the earth. It's bigger than that. It's more than that. He died so that we can have a relationship with our Father. He died so that this world is not it. He died for eternity. He died for a bigger picture. And we have to remain eternity-minded. Because what prosperity teachers want to do is make you think about today and tomorrow and maybe next year. But we need to remain eternity-minded. I'm currently studying the book of Ecclesiastes. I just finished it now. And it's very interesting because obviously it's written by King Solomon, who is the wisest man. And a lot of the book is him basically saying that those that just live for this world, the thing that they look for and live with is vanity. It's futile. It's fleeting. And he gives lots of different examples. I definitely encourage you to read it. It's very poetic. That if you base your life and everything you have is based on what's happening in this world, it's so wasted. That you can build and build and you can save for a house and you can have all these investments. That's fantastic. But if that is just it, it's vanity. Because you die and it's gone. You die and some other guy just picks it up and keeps it moving. Think about all the houses we have. Yes, we strive for home ownership. It's an amazing thing. But once you die, it's no longer yours. It's gone. And that's why we have to be eternity minded. I was mourning this month. My uncle, who passed suddenly, like he just had a heart attack in the gym. And he, very, very godly man. And he spent the last 2 to 3 years building a church in Nigeria. He was building a branch of my old church in Nigeria. And I kid you not, he died on a Thursday, and the 2 weeks after that, he was going to go and pick up the keys to that church he's been working on for 2 to 3 years. Him and my mum were going to go and pick up the keys. And when he died, I said, God, like all people, like he was working for your kingdom. He was literally spent years of time and money to build a church in Nigeria to glorify your name. So why would you take him? God, not even just that. Let me not question you. But why would you not just let him see the finished building? Just let him see what his hard work had. Just let him see what his hard work had done. I'm trying to not cry on the stage every single time I preach. Why didn't you just let him? Thank you. I question God, like, why did you not just let him see what he had done at the very least? But I had to be reminded that we live with eternity in mind. Like, he was such a hard worker of Christ that what he's going to see in heaven and the rewards that he's going to see in heaven is way more than even the building work which he has done. Way more. But I have to believe that. Because as a Christian, that needs to be the forefront of my mind always, that this life is not just it. And therefore, when you have prosperity teachers that are saying, live your best life now, get all these good things now, they're shortchanging you. And the moment we hyper-focus on this life was prosperity and health and wealth, name it and claim it, God should bless me because I've got so much faith, and therefore it's become a transactional relationship. The more faith that I put in, the more materialistic things God's going to give me, the more tithe I put in, the more money God's going to give me. When it becomes transactional, you miss the whole thing. You completely belittle the cross. But more importantly, you would be surprised that there's some prayer request that you have made that would actually destroy you. There's some things that you are seeking God for, praying to God for, but if he actually gave it to you, it would ruin you. And I know that's hard to believe, right? Because you want these things. You know it's for your good. Like, God, just give me the Porsche. Trust me, it's not going to ruin me. God, just give me the house. Look, just let me win the lottery. Trust me, I'm going to handle it well. But God knows that certain things are just not good for you. And as a parent, I know you want social media. I know you want Instagram. I know you want Snapchat. But just like God, I know what is good for you. Amen. Amen, church. So prosperity teaching is a teaching against Christ because it distracts us from the true value of the cross. Sub number two, elevation teaching. So I heard a sermon some years ago, and I kid you not, this guy got on stage and the moderator really gassed him up. Man of God is in the house. Guys, you're going to be so blessed by this word. The man of God is coming. And he came and he started with one scripture. And the next 45 minutes was him just talking about how spiritual he is. He spent the whole time saying, look, when I pray, chains are broken. If you want me to do something in your life, bring an offering and I'll declare something in your life. He said, when I pray, God takes me to the third heavens. Me and God are just communing. When I pray, Apostle Paul, me and Apostle Paul are just sharing notes. When I pray, something happens. And he spent so much time just talking about himself and the power of himself. Now, I'm not saying it's not true, because I definitely believe we have intercessors and prayer warriors that when they pray, something changes. Amen. But the problem was he used an opportunity to be on that pulpit to talk about self and glorify self. So people walked away not saying, wow, what a convicting word. I want to go and search the scriptures. I want to learn more about God. People would have walked away and said, wow, what a powerful man of God. I want to be more like him. And that's the danger. With elevation teachings, it teaches that rather than testing the Spirit, we should begin to worship the Spirit. Rather than searching the scriptures, we should keep searching for the next person's sermon series. Does it encourage us to want to know God for ourselves and be in the Word for ourselves for our own firm foundation? It encourages us to copy other people. It encourages us to want to be like the people on the stage. Look, guys, you don't want to be me. I'm not perfect. Anyone that takes this mic is not perfect. We've just accepted an invitation to share the word on this stage. There is nothing special about me. Any of you could be on the stage sharing the word right now. But elevation teachers, they stand up here and they say, look, I'm a man of God, and I'm going to give you 7 steps for God to answer your prayers. It's going to cost you £50, but join anyway. And when you learn these 7 steps, God's going to answer your prayers the same way he answers my prayers. And then you start following preachers and prophets against every single conference, you're there. He's in America, you're there. He's in Australia, you're there. He's in China, you're there. £60 tickets, £80 tickets, you're there following the preachers to catch a word from God. But the deeper issue is for this generation is that I feel like people don't want to wait on the Lord anymore. They want answers, and they want answers quickly. So if a man of God or a woman of God says, look, come to my conference, join my course and pay that £100, I'm going to give you an answer from the Lord now. And that feeds into our Google, Ask Jeeves kind of innate desire to want to have knowledge, right? Because someone's promised me that if I pay this price, I'm going to get information from God. But I want to encourage you guys that there's still power in waiting on the Lord, amen? So that those that wait upon the Lord, amen. There's still power in waiting. And the problem that my own personal gripe with these preachers as well, I don't want to attack anyone, but my personal gripe is that it kind of gives like Ponzi scheme, like Avon. Like, I wanna, honestly, because it's like, they say things like, oh, when you see those ads on Facebook, where they say, I want to show you how I quit my 9-to-5 and now I make £50,000 from my bedroom. Join my course and then you'll know how to make £50,000 from your bedroom. It's giving Ponzi scheme that you need to do something to receive something from God through them, and it has to be from them. But you know, they're the clay. God is the potter and they're the clay. It says in Isaiah 64 verse 8, "Yet you, Lord, are our Father. We are the clay, you are the potter." Some of us have been chasing clays. Chasing clays with no life. Lifeless clays. God is the potter. If I had a choice to worship clay or to worship the potter with the creativity and the hands and the power, why would I be worshiping the clay? And don't get me wrong, God uses people in a miraculous way. We are so gifted with speakers, apostles, prophets, evangelists. They are definitely gifted. God has molded them in a special way. But we can't worship the clay. We can never lose our sight and lose our gaze of Jesus. It's only Jesus we want to be like, not the clay. Amen? And the last type of antichrist, against Christ teaching is the extra biblical teaching. So it's one thing not to preach. No, it's one thing to twist the truth to suit your needs. But it's another thing to not preach the word of God at all. It's one thing to add extra biblical teachings to the Bible. And these preachers, they will use narrow gate language. They use all the key terms, Holy Spirit, power, dynamis, healing. They'll speak in tongues. They know all the narrow gate language. Because false prophets, as we can see from this picture, are normally under the radar. It tells us in the scripture that they're like wolves in sheep's clothing. I don't know if anyone realized that. That's a wolf in sheep's clothing. No one noticed? Guys, we're in the third week. That is wolves in sheep clothing. So Jesus says in the book of Matthew, Matthew chapter 7, verse 15, he says, "Beware," which means be aware, "that amongst the sheep there will be wolves." That means you have to be on alert, be guided, be equipped by the word so that you can be ready to spot out a wolf. Amen? I remember that we went to LA for Christmas. Yeah, it was really nice actually. And I was really excited to go to an American church, because you know when you see on TV, American churches are so big, it's just so powerful, everyone is just, you know, on it, and the songs are amazing, the vocals, the halls are amazing. So I was really, really excited. And we went to a very, very famous church. I'm not going to name them. Went to a very famous church, big community, big church. They've got like four services, and her dad is a mega preacher. So we went to this church now, and I was very, very hopeful. I was very, very hopeful. And it was a Christmas Sunday. So it wasn't, Christmas wasn't on the Sunday last year, but like the Sunday nearest to Christmas. So I thought, yeah, this word, people are going to give their life to Christ. This word is going to be powerful. This is the Christmas service. So it's going to be mad. Now this man read the Christmas story about Jesus being, you know, born in a manger. And he said, "Oh, this story really links well to that famous song, Silent Night." Then he recited the lyrics of Silent Night. Then he said, "Do you know what? When you guys have any issues or face any issues of this world, just be silent because of the lyric, Silent Night." I thought, okay, that's a bit of a reach, but let me see where you're going. He said, "When you're in turmoil and you're upset and you're struggling, be silent. But if you can't be silent, just take a deep breath." So I had to pause for a second. And he said, "If you struggle to take a deep breath when you're having, you know, issues in life, you know what you should do?" And I kid you not, he went to the back and he came back, had a little mixture, and said, "If you struggle to take a breath or be silent, just do this." He started blowing bubbles on the stage. Esther, am I lying? He started blowing bubbles on the stage. He said, "If you have any issues in life, if you're warring against any something, take a deep breath." He said, "When you are going through difficult times or you are lacking faith, just be silent." He said, "When you're going through struggles or, you know, you're doubting God, blow bubbles. Man of God, if I'm going through issues, I shouldn't be silent. I need to pray. If I'm going through difficulties, I don't need to take a deep breath. I need to pray. If I'm going through times of doubt and I'm struggling to trust God, it's not time to blow bubbles. I need to pray. And if you're on stage as a man of God or a woman of God, what you're supposed to be doing is equipping the saints with scriptures so they know how to pray. That is the job of someone on this pulpit. For goodness sake, this is not a TED talk. This is the pulpit to share the word of the living God. This is the time to equip you guys for difficult times. This is the time to make you stronger. This is the time to go in a team huddle. Excuse me. This is the time to be in a team huddle and build each other up and sharpen each other. This is not the time to blow bubbles. Amen. I'm actually still like, I'm really annoyed. And ask TJ, like we left, I was so grieved because I was thinking like a whole Christmas Sunday service and you're saying that the believers should blow bubbles and you even brought props on top of that. Okay, I'm wrapping up. So my last point, so that was John calls us to test every spirit, action, because there's false prophets and the spirit of Antichrist can be a distraction. Some of the Antichrist teachings was prosperity teaching, elevation teaching, and extra biblical teaching. Now, point three, my last point, transaction. Pastor John lovingly wraps up his point by saying, little children, you are from God and have overcome them. For he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Let me show you something. So remember Queen Sheba? Do you remember Queen Sheba? How long did it take for her to go and see Solomon? 3 years. It took her 3 years because she was willing to take 3 years to go and hear the wisdom of God through Solomon. Now check this out. In Luke 11, verse 31, Jesus is speaking to the crowds. And he says, the queen of the south, which is Queen Sheba, will rise up at the judgment with the men of this generation and condemn them. For she came from the ends of the earth, Peckham, ends of the earth, to hear the wisdom of Solomon. And behold, something greater than Solomon is here. What Jesus was saying is that, look, you guys know from the Old Testament that Queen Sheba traveled 3 years to hear the wisdom of God through Solomon. And now Jesus is speaking to the congregation and saying, look, something even better, greater than Solomon is right in front of you. Family, we have Jesus' words in the Bible. Something even greater than 3 years of travel is now on our phone, on the internet, hardback Bibles. We now have that with us. It doesn't end there. John 16, verse 7 says, this is when Jesus had resurrected. He died, being buried, he'd come back to life, and he was speaking to them before he went to heaven. And he says, John 16, verse 7, nevertheless, I tell you, it is to your advantage, everyone say advantage, that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. Everyone stand up for me, please. Queen Sheba sought after God's word with such tenacity that is embarrassing. She was willing to travel by camel for 3 years. Do you know how many birthdays she must have celebrated on the road? 3 years to hear the wisdom of God through Solomon. Then Jesus comes and says, okay, I'm now on the scene and I'm giving you a word which is greater than what she traveled for. And that word is now in our scriptures. And then Jesus comes back and he says, look, I've been with you. I've given you my word. My apostles, they've written it down. You know, it's there for you now. But it's to your advantage. There's something even better than me will come. When I go, transaction. by the grace of God, we hear all these things about, you know, distractions and the importance of testing the word. But by the mercy of God, he has said that he's going to give us a little piece of him to be with us always. Isn't that beautiful? We've all got a piece of God with us, walking with us every single day. None of us have to travel 3 years. None of us have to find out where Jesus is preaching. He's literally with us. Do you know how jealous the Old Testament people would be? They had to wait for the Levites and the priests and everyone to come and tell them what God is saying. They had to go and find the temple, and, you know, there at the temple is where God was. But now God is with us. We are his living temple. He is right here. And now before I move on, I want to give an opportunity to anyone that hasn't yet experienced that transaction. You in your heart know you haven't fully surrendered your life to God. You have not made Jesus Lord over your life, and you know you're not walking with the Holy Spirit. If that's you, I want to encourage you to come to the front today for us to pray with you. If you know that you've been in church maybe for years, you've always attended church, you know all the key scriptures, you've heard, but you know deep in your heart you've not surrendered fully to him. You know that you are still Lord over your own life. I want to encourage you to give your life to him today. I want to encourage you to come and experience that transaction. I want to encourage you today to not just be a hearer of the word, but a doer of the word. If that's you, I want you to come forward, give your life to him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Can we celebrate God? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What's your name? Let's bless God, guys. Hallelujah. Isn't God good? Isn't God, like, someone has now decided to give their life to God. Another one. Another one. Another one. Hallelujah. If I could just get some elders or ministers to come and pray with them and exchange details. But for the rest of us, I really want us to have a team huddle, if that's okay. I want us to gather in groups of threes or fours, wherever you are. And I want you to have a team huddle and pray for one another. Whether it is that you want to pray to be more in your word and have more of a hunger for the scriptures, or maybe you've had experiences of distraction and false teachings and you want to unlearn those bad practices, or maybe it's that you don't feel like you're fully engaging with the Holy Spirit and you want to be encouraged and be sharpened to understand what it means to be walking with the Holy Spirit, I want us to gather in groups of threes. Anyone near you, get into groups of threes or fours and have a team huddle and pray for one another. Threes or fours, anyone that's around you, hold their hand and have a team huddle. Ask them, what do they want to be prayed for? Christ and pray for them.
Firm foundation, the rock on which I stand, when everything around me is shaken, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. He's never let me down.
Pray for, like,
he's
you're praying for yourself. Team huddle.
So why would he fail now? He won't fail. And I still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense, and I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength, 'cause I've built my life on Jesus. He's never let me down. He's faithful through He won't. Yes. He won't. He won't fail. He won't fail. He won't. He won't.
Beyond all understanding, Lord, which surpasses all understanding, will guard our hearts in Christ Jesus, Lord. Lord, thank you, Lord, for giving us and pouring your spirit into us, Lord, and giving us that peace that surpasses all understanding, Lord. As we leave here, Lord, go into our week, Lord, I pray, Lord, that your peace will just reign. Your spirit, Lord, just reign. We will move in your spirit, Lord. Every single thing we do this week, Lord, we will just move through your spirit, Lord. And the peace that surpasses all understanding, Lord, will guard our hearts against any false doctrine, against any false prophet, against any sheep in wolf's clothing. It will guard our hearts. In the mighty name of Jesus, I pray. And the church says, amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you for joining us. just a couple of few things before I close. I was here dancing when they were doing happy birthdays. I didn't know we did have some people that did have their birthday this week. We have them in service. So yeah, Camille, if you see Camille, she's up there. So it was her birthday during the week. So give her a big hug if you see her, and if you wanna bless her with some cash dollar as well, you know, feel free to. But yeah, I hope everyone has a good week. And as TJ said, this is a Man United church. We've got a big game coming up. So as you're leaving, make sure to, you know, hold it with prayer. And if any fan is visiting the stadium, going to Wembley, or watching online, just may they celebrate a win. Yes, but thank you for joining us online, and thank you. See you.